Here are my top 5 things not to do, or mistakes that I've made, mistakes to avoid in your handmade business. Hi, my name is Vic Walker and I'm here to help makers and creators turn their hobby into a business. Oh my God, it is crazy times. Here in Melbourne, we have just started our day 2 of a semi-lockdown. I mean, we're still allowed to go out and exercise, but we can't socialize with big groups, and we've got to keep 1.5 meters apart because of the coronavirus. And looking back in a couple of years' times, it's just going to be weird just to remember this point in time for your small business. And I'm really hoping that we all survive through this. A lot of us will either have to shut down or go out of business because at the moment in Melbourne, all the shops, all the non-essentials like pubs and cafes have to shut their doors. The boutiques, the retail shops are still staying open, but I think it's only going to last for another week. And then the lockdown will then happen, and who knows how long it will go for. So hopefully I'm wishing you all the best and that you can survive through this, or at least pick it up again when it's all over. But in the meantime, keep moving through it. So anyway, having said that, I'm going to go back to the 5 top mistakes that I've made in business, and some of them I'm still figuring out how to improve on. Number one is doing things for free, especially for friends and families. When you're asked to do something and then you don't ask for money, and you're setting that precedent up, and people expect you to do things for free. And that's a really hard one when it comes to friends and family, because even yesterday I made the same mistake. You know, like I had a friend text through saying that she needed a birthday card for a surprise birthday that we're all going to. And it's not a normal size card, but it's a super size card. So I had to design it to go and print it out, custom made. And I kind of thought it was an order, but then I went to deliver it to her and she said, "Do you want any money for this?" And it was only, say, $10-$15, and we spent that much money sharing each other coffee every week. I got put in that awkward position where I just said, "Nah, it's okay, don't worry about it," you know, because it's a friend. And then I walked away feeling a little bit resentful. I mean, not so much resentment, because it's not that much money, but you don't go into a shop to buy something and saying, "Oh, is payment optional?" And it happens all the time with me, because it's an art business and people don't value it, or my time's not worth anything. And I think I am at fault because I'm setting that precedent, giving cards out for free, maybe because it's paper goods and it's not that much money. It's such a fine line. I'm sure you've had been put in this position as well. And I guess we've just got to work out a way of how to set that expectations up. I have gone through that with my public speaking, that people asked for me to speak at their kids' school free. And I worked out that if I got an agent, I can just say, "Look, my agent manages that," and then, you know, that solves the problem. But for this business, I don't know, it's just a hard one. Number two, the second mistake that I often make is not to follow up on leads. So people say, "Yeah, I want this," and I just kind of wait and think, oh, you know, if they want it, they'll follow up on it. But if you don't follow up, and if you're not in their face in a nice way, you'll get forgotten. You know, people forget, or they put things on the back burner, or they'll order it from the easiest source. So if someone else comes and hassle them, or someone else comes and gives them an easy solution, they probably go, "Yeah, okay, that will do," because I just don't have time and I can't be bothered chasing up on somebody. So if you've got a lead, follow up with an email or phone call. The fortune is in the follow-up. If you're enjoying this video, please click the subscribe button down below, hit that notification bell, and leave me a comment on other things if you've got other mistakes that you've made as a handmade business. Number three is listen to your customers. So they're telling you something, like say for example, I've got a shop in Olinda Collective and I should be selling local iconic images there, like the Puffing Billy or Mrs. Marple or something like that, and I do, and they move, but I try to push my Melbourne trends there, and I've been doing that for a year now, and I shouldn't really, because people escape to go to this town and they want a bit of something from that town. So your shops will know their customers better than you do. Find out what they need and what they're selling and listen to them, and then give them more of what's selling in their shop, or just make more products that are similar so that you can expand on your range and your products. People also appreciate being listened to. You know, they appreciate you taking their advice and you paying attention to them. So you build up a greater relationship if you actually listen to your customers. Number four is a contradiction of number three. Don't always listen to your customers, because sometimes they don't know what they don't know. So if a particular range is selling for me in other similar shops, make sure that you suggest it to them, but suggest it in a safe and win-win way. So for example, you know, I've got these football cards. So I say in the football season, try these football cards because they're selling really well. And if you don't sell them after the football season, I will exchange it for you for other cards that you know sells in your shop. So that gives them a low risk alternative. 90% of the times they do sell, because I know that, you know, the people around that area, or the people in Melbourne, for example, do buy footy cards. They're footy crazy. It's a hit miss sometimes, you know. You sort of have to take your own risk as well. And for me, if it doesn't sell in one shop, I know that I can sell those cards in another shop. So it's not that risky for me. Number five is try things in small quantities. So I have in the past think, oh, you know, I can make these things, and if I made 1,000 of them, the unit cost would then be lower and I'll make a better profit margin on it. And what happens is, like my wooden key rings, for example, just didn't sell. So I've got a whole box of them, 1,000 of them sitting in my garage, not making me any money. What I should have done is write them off as a test exercise and not make any money, or make very low profit margin, to see if they work first. And that goes with my card designs as well. Some designs work better than others. So if I just did a short print run but pay a bit more for it, then I could test the market. And if they prove to be popular, my next order will be a lot more, because I know that I can sell them. And here is a bonus number six, is to pick your customers well, or I should say, to let go of the customers that you're not happy with. So if you're a wholesaler like me, there are shops that I have let go because I don't like dealing with them for various reasons, whether they are not treating me well, or they're not ordering a lot, you know, because I'm a wholesaler, and sometimes shops order one or two of each items, and that's not how it works. You know, with, say for example, with cars, you order it in fours or sixes and you have a minimum order. I mean, it's flexible. You've got to work out what works for you and what works with that particular shop. So it's not all a blanket black and white situation. But if it's not worth your time and you're not enjoying dealing with that customer, or if it's too hard, you don't have to be friends with the customer, if they make it too hard, or you're really feeling unhappy, then let them go. I'm going to make another video on invoicing and different expectations of payments and consignment, which as a rule of thumb, I would try if you can avoid consignments. And I would talk about consignment, just, you know, the pros and cons of consignment. Stay tuned for some more videos on that. Just keep sharing information, sharing the love, and sharing your experiences. If you are enjoying this video and you want to learn more about how to grow your handmade business, stay on and watch the next video. Thank you.